while you're on the ball. Isn't it?
Yeah.
going to do a sound check on that. Don't panic, it was stuffy.
There's heaps of us with hearing aids.
Yes, I am.
That saved a wretch like me. I was amazing.
And 2 1 2, testing 1 2.
Yeah. I
Can I get you a glass of water?
Oh, yeah, thanks.
Sitting there in a towel. So if you're sitting there in a towel, right, so she's coming up to that. She's ready to meet me.
Thank you.
I
more chairs here than you reckon there are. What a beautiful song to start off this afternoon's celebration of life service for Mrs. Patricia Kathleen Graham. My name is Lou Saunders and I'm a celebrant. It is my privilege, it's my honour to be able to conduct today's service. And Janice, I want to thank you for the time we were able to spend the other day just talking about Mum's life, her journey, the outstanding woman she was, the resilience that she had to work through life. And, you know, to be born in 1927 would have meant a lot of change in her life. Would have meant a lot of things, would have been a challenge, both financially and physically, for housing, for employment, with depressions and wars. Just an amazing journey of her generation. So I want to welcome you all here today on behalf of the family, and it's good to be able to come together and share those memories. And sadly, it's at funerals we stop in our busy lives. We pause, we put a line through our diary and we stop. And we remember Janice. And today is about remembering her, about sharing those memories, about supporting one another. And I'm sure that each of you are here to support those who are grieving her passing. You know, she lived an incredibly long life. We can't dispute that. 96 years is just such a long, long life. And she did well. So that's part of the honour we have here today. I'm going to ask now if you wouldn't mind just checking your mobile phones for me, please, just to make sure they're off. But if they do need to be on, just on silent mode, would be appreciated. Thank you. At the close of the service, we're going to take the opportunity to place some floral tributes on the coffin out at the hearse. If you'd like to follow us out as we leave the service to pay your last respects to Patricia, to Pat, and say your goodbyes there. If you don't want to go outside, that's okay, but we will be coming back in to have some afternoon tea here and tea and coffee and some food, and we'll run the photo show again. And, you know, thank you, train. Nice to have Pat supported by the local Cockatrain, isn't it? But sometimes, you know, when you come to a service like this and stories are shared and photos are showed, you go, oh, I remember that day, or I remember that time, or I wasn't there that day, but do you remember when? And it's so good afterwards to just have that time of pause again, that formality done and the relaxed time come forward and just come around the photographs and come around tea and coffee and some afternoon tea and just, again, share those life journey moments with us. So today is a day of sadness. We can't deny that. It's a day of someone's life passing from this life to the next. But it's also a day of celebration that 96 years has passed in her life. And all of you have been connected and involved in her life. Probably not all of you for all of her life, looking at the younger ones here and the older ones. Can I put it that way? I wasn't looking at you. But that's life, isn't it? We come into people's lives at different parts of life's journey. And I often relate life to being like a journey on a bus, that not everyone gets on the depot and rides the bus to the end of the route, that people get on the bus and people get off the bus, and people ride the whole journey and people only ride a short part of the journey. And life to all of us is like that with the people in our lives. We may not see someone for years and years and years, and then we catch up with them and it's like we only saw them yesterday. So I'm hoping in our farewell to Pat today, that's what it'll be about. It'll be a catching up to share Pat's life as if everything was just yesterday. So before we share her life story, allow me, if you will, just to open with this beautiful poem. It's called Miss Me, But Let Me Go. I know it's a very pertinent poem to where we are today, that for those who love and have been around Pat for a while and the impact of her passing has hit pretty hard, you will miss her. But she's probably saying to you all here today, miss me, but let me go. When I come to the end of the road and the sun has set for me, I want no rights in a gloom-filled room. Why cry for a soul set free? Miss me a little, but not for long, and not with your head bowed low. Remember the love that once we shared. Miss me, but let me go. For this is a journey we must all take, and each must go it alone. It's all part of the master plan, a step on the road to home.
when you are lonely and sick at heart. Go to the friends we know. Laugh at all the things we used to do. Miss me, but let me go. I'm going to invite Damien and Kerry up now, and they're going to share a little bit of Pat's journey with us. And before I forget, I want to welcome those who have joined us on live stream as well. It's good that family are able to join us without having to travel those distances. And this is one benefit of modern technology. They can be here without being here. So for those on live stream, thank you for joining us. Well, Damien and Kerry, if I can invite you forward now, please. That would be lovely. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone, for coming out today. Patricia Kathleen Graham, Neem Olds, born 12th of September 1927 in Goulston, New South Wales. Fifth born of nine children to William and Ethel Olds. Nana didn't have an easy life. Living on the farm, it was hard work. Through the Depression, girls were trained as domestics and boys trained as farmhands. Just before the war, Nana went to a local dance where she met a handsome Navy man called George Alfred Graham.
Nana and Papa were married on the 14th of December 1946 at St James Church, Tarramurra, New South Wales. A year later, on the 28th of December 1947, Uncle Harry was born. Oh, you might need to do this. After living in various locations, the family moved to South Australia, and in 1949
The family then moved to South Australia in 1949 and lived in Hague Avenue, Hyde Park. Over the years, Nana and Papa had more children, Ronnie, Trish, Colin, Marilyn, Carol, and Auntie Janice. Nana and Papa always made the house feel welcoming, always full of not only their children, but other children as well, or blow-ins as Nana would say. We'd like to invite Auntie Trish up now to do a reading. She will explain as she goes.
This beautiful letter was popped into my little box. My deepest sympathy to Pat, Marilyn, and Carol, and families. Your mum was a very important part of my life, and I will always remember her fondly. Hague Avenue was a safe haven for me as a child. Carol and I were friends at Arnding Primary School, and I would spend so much time with the Grahams. I recall the time we met, your mum asked me to put the kettle on, and I didn't know how to use the electric stove. If the stove rings were meant to be white, if they ran out on red. Anyway, I put my hand on it and burnt my little hand. Helen quickly put my hand under cold running water, so I soon learnt. Sitting at your kitchen table and being fed like a queen, you always seem to have enough food to feed an army and plenty of food. And a pantry full of food, sorry. Something I wasn't used to. I would often stay overnight on weekends, all of us crammed into the girls' room when it was cold with the kerosene heater on, which always amazes me as the room was rather untidy with clothes strewn all over the place. It was here that I met Auntie June. She was a special and treated us as all as lovely. Colin and Maria were always so loving, lovely and caring too. I will always cherish the opportunity to travel. We all clambered into the Gallant and drove all the way to Narra Court near Mount Gambier to visit your family. That night I slept in bed with Mrs. Graham, but I had to go to the toilet, which entailed walking outside a far way and using a drop box. That was an eye-opener for me. While watching out for the cows, we were on a farm somewhere. When my sister Lynn got married, a few of us kids stayed overnight. That just how accommodating the Grahams were. Your mum made the boys polish their shoes the morning of the wedding. Well, not good enough. They were sent back to do them again. It makes me laugh now, but I don't think the boys thought it was very funny at the time. I could go on and on, however, just want you to know that all will remain in my heart as the great fun times. Yes, even when the house was crowded and Mrs. G would be shouting out at all the kids for some reason or another, the house was full of love. My thoughts are with you all. Mavis.
Sure. Thank you for that. So that summed up how it was growing up in the Hague Avenue. Nana was an interesting character, quick-witted, loved to banter, nothing was off-limit, or she had no filter, as the kids would say these days. I'm sure many of us here would have plenty of stories to tell about her jokes and her humour. Nana was always there for her grandkids. Nana and Papa's relationship was tested, and when Papa was left on the farm at Yucca with Kerry and Alan, as Nana stayed at Two Wells to raise Desmond, Zoe and myself. Nana would return to the farm on weekends and during the school holidays when she could. Nana and Papa's love for each other stayed strong through it all. Nana and Papa loved to travel. Even after Papa passed, Nana continued her passion for travelling and would often enjoy trips away with Legacy and attend dinners and events. Nana remained active within the RSL after Papa had passed, gathering up gifts for the prizes for the raffles. And as much as us great grandkids hated it, Nana loved her gardening. Kids, we were told to get outside, pull weeds when we were at Yucca. Never fun. In the later years, Nana's love for spending time in the garden, especially with her roses. She also looked forward every morning to go to Wendy's to drink her green tea and to catch up with her friends. In the later years, Nana kept herself busy by driving the old people, as she would call them, to their doctor's appointment. I used to ask her, who's older than you, Nana? But she always said, with their ills and ailments, they're all older than me. Nana's favourite catchphrase, she was always fighting fit. She was ready for whoever it was. We never knew who she was going to fight, but she was ready for them. Nana was very adventurous, not only with travelling, but she absolutely loved it when she went on hot air ballooning for her 80th birthday. For her 90th, she actually wanted to go skydiving, but somehow her doctor talked her out of it, thank God. It's hard not having Nana here. The room seems empty without her. and there's less laughter without her here and inappropriate comments. I will forever miss her for that. I'm sure there is so much more we could say or have missed. But how much time can we spend talking about someone who lived a full and happy life? She had her tragedies too along the way, with the passing of her three sons and the love of her life, Papa George. However, in true Nana spirit, she kept going in life, but never forgot them. Nana left behind four daughters, 17 grandkids, 30 plus great grandchildren, and we think about 11 great grandchildren, and many more foster kids around as well. Kerry would like to say something now.
First, I have a letter from Auntie Janice that I'm going to read on behalf of her. I can get it out. My beautiful mum, I'll treasure our memories together, spending time at the Goolwa
Ranch,
taking in the bird life and the peace and tranquility which she loved. Her garden was her passion. We were having a cuppa out the front. Mum looks at some weeds amongst the flowers. I'm going to pull them out. Sure enough, we're both down kneeling on a cushion. It was a struggle getting Mum up, but we achieved it. Having a good laugh. Mum was a giving soul. If anybody needed her help, she was there. Mum has given me strength, her courage throughout life. I'm so thankful for the support of the carers that were able to help her.
Help me.
Have Mum stay in her home as she wanted. I would buy us a treat, a vanilla slice to share with Mum. Mum would say, "Oh, where did you get that from?" Mum was such a joy to be around. She was a privilege to be your daughter. Love, Janice. All right, I have a little bit too. Let's hope I can get through this.
Yes, you can.
Mine's on my phone, not written, because I'm a little bit lazy.
Why do you go hard?
Well, I guess now Damien and I can stop arguing over who was Nana's favourite out of the two of us. Because I think my Nana had a lot of special people in her life, and I think everyone Nana knew was special to her in many different ways. I'll forever cherish my memories, like the way my Nana used to sit in the car with her hand rested on the back of Papa's seat when he was driving, ready to slap him good if he wasn't concentrating on the road. I remember we'd all jump because she'd scare the shit out of us all, including Papa. Then she'd give us a crown mint and tell us to sit back and be quiet. To the time Nana was on holiday at my house in Strathmerton, we were gardening and I saw a great big bloody snake. I came back around to the side of the house and said to Nana, "Stay here, there's a bloody huge snake around there." And Nana tried to grab the shovel I was holding, saying, "Give me that shovel, I'll get him." Mind you, Nan was in her 80s at this time, and she was always such a fierce lady. I did stop her from trying to get that snake, though. Our Nana and Papa were the backbone of our family, and because of them, I value my family connections. Nana and Papa were a huge part of my life, and I have a lot to thank them for. The love and guidance they gave me very much contributed to the person I am today. I hope I can be as good a grandma to my grandchildren as Nana was to me. Love you, Nana. You'll forever be in my heart, still fighting fit. Now, I think I would hear my Nana say, "Stop your tears, girl. I lived a good life." I think her positive attitude to fighting fit and her love of green tea may have helped her live a long life. Funny how green tea keeps coming up, because I think Damien might have a funny story about Nana and her love for green tea.
You're going to make me share it.
Yeah.
All right. Just to give you the background, I took Nana over for Sarah's 21st, which is Kerry's eldest daughter. And it was a lovely trip. I enjoyed spending time driving along with Nana. We stopped off at this little town at a roadhouse. Nana wanted her green tea, and we grabbed a little bite to eat, which is great. So we get in the car, we're driving, just about to take off. And next minute, Nana yells out, "Oh, I've got a fanny full of green tea." And I went, "Oh my God, I am still in therapy." She spilled her drink on herself, but that didn't matter to Nana. She still had to share. So we finally arrived at Kerry's place, probably what, 10, 15 minutes in the house, and everyone knew the story. Everyone at that party knew the story. Nobody left without knowing about her fanny full of green tea. And it still haunts me. And I get reminders of green tea all the time now. Thanks, Kerry.
There's a good story in every family, isn't there? At least one. Thanks, Damien. Thanks, Kerry. Thank you, Janice, for sharing those valuable memories of Pat's life. Just wondering whether there's anyone else here this afternoon who would like to share a story, an occasion. Yep. Here we go. A few words would be great. Thank you so much.
Paul from the local RSL, and that girl, I was looking at this thing here and I started laughing at myself. Pat, or little Patty as we called her, did the raffle. She loved it. Every Friday night she'd turn up. Back in those days, there'd be coat hangers with all the woolen stuff around them, you know, probably number one prize in those days. But then she'd turn up with this sort of stuff. Easter, there'd be... She just loved being part of the community, right? And that was... Everybody knew her. She'd walk around, there's little Patty, at the supermarket, down the main street, here, there and everywhere. George was... I didn't have a lot to do with him. I didn't get here till 94. But I'll never forget, they used to have a table where these certain just sat there every Friday night. And that was their area. No one was allowed to be there, right? Anyhow, when one of them passed, the chair had come forward, right? And no one was allowed to sit there. So another one had go, so there was another two spare chairs, and it went on and on. So anyhow, at the time there, I said to the president, "We'll fix this." So we got the octagonal table, or whatever you want to call it, and I put it up in the loft. Well, then they come and they said, "Where's our table gone?" I said, "We sent it with George and the other fella that died, right? So, and it got rid of it, it was too sad and all that sort of thing." So that was the way we sort of got rid of that little bit of angst. And little Patty had come along, she said, "That's the best thing you ever done, Paul." And I was just saying to... I was going to get to that. The party isn't over, right? As I said to Janice, George is buried out at our local cemetery, right? And Pat is obviously his the right hand. He thought he was the right hand, but Pat was the right hand. And there will be further down the track when they'll unite again. So certainly it's not over yet. It'll be just an informal thing, and I'm sure the girl will let you know what's going on. We'll get out there and have a bit of laugh and put them together, eh? But, yeah, I'm glad she passed by in my life anyhow, that lady. She gave me plenty of fun. And I give her plenty too.
I have to take this opportunity because I told her I would do it. I'm the old Wendy's man. I'm the one that got her that puppy dog in 2006. And she became one of my best customers, and hardest too. If I bring my own green tea bag, how much are you going to charge me for the water? Now and again I'd get her into a donut. But Pat was one of the group. They started off four people, and we got to around 18 people every morning, 8:30 to 9:00, and it was the chat and the mag, and yep. And my friendship with her was very much like a distant son. And then she met my mother, Lorna, from Wyala. And, excuse me, Mum passed away last year, 103. And those two were double trouble when they were together. And I just wanted to say to you that to know Pat as I did from being the old Wendy's man, don't think I'll ever get past that. The friendship that she made with my mother and from the other people in the Wendy's group was something to remember, and we'll always remember for that. Thank you.
Just make sure I get that right. Was that the old man from Wendy's or the old Wendy's man? Great little memory, though. Thank you for sharing that. And, you know, life is like that. Those little things that happen in that journey, those little memories that sit there in the background until we come to days like today and go, oh, I remember that. I knew that face, those sort of things. So that's wonderful. Is anyone else this afternoon want to share a story, a memory? I'm sure over tea and coffee there'll be lots of little chats, lots of little memories. So let's pause in this part of the service and let's enjoy a photo tribute to Pat's life.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved.
Will lead me home.
was blind, but now I see.
Some great photos in there. Thank you for allowing us into your lives to share Pat's life. On many a trip, on many a journey, on many a visit, we say goodbye to someone, whether it be a face-to-face, whether it be over the phone, whether it be in an email or a text, we say our goodbyes. But today we say goodbye. Or as the Hebrew language says, Mizpah, until we meet again. And so we come to that time in this service where we acknowledge Pat's busy hands, her body that was prepared to be fighting fit, both lie still and at peace. But Pat's spirit lives on. It lives on in all the lives she touched, whether you be a long-time friend, whether you be a short-term friend, you've touched her life and she's touched yours. So we're going to close with this beautiful poem. Not sure who wrote this poem. It's by an unknown author. It's called One at Rest. Think of me as one at rest. For me you should not weep. I have no pain, no troubled thoughts, for I am just asleep. The living, thinking me that was, is now forever still. And life goes on without me now, as time forever will. If your heart is heavy now, because I've gone away, dwell not long upon it, friends, for none of us can stay. Those of you who like me, I sincerely thank you all. But for those of you who love me, I thank you most of all. And in my fleeting lifespan, as time went rushing by, I found some time to hesitate, to laugh, to love, to cry. Matters it now, if time began, if time will ever cease? I was here, I used it all, and now I am at peace. Family and friends, I'm going to ask if you're able, would you stand with me as we speak words of committal over Pat here today. Pat, go forth from this world. Know that you are loved beyond measure. That you'll be missed more than words can say. That you'll be remembered and that you'll be cherished and that love will never end. We will hold you close within us, and there you will remain, to be with us throughout the years, into our lives, until we meet again. And as we now hold your memory in our hearts, and send you on your final journey, may you forever rest in peace, with the certain knowledge that our love goes with you. Family and friends, through everything there is a season, time to every purpose on earth, time to be born, and sadly, a time to die. In this last act, in sorrow, but without fear, in love and in appreciation, we commit Pat to her natural end. Family and friends, we come from the dust, and we return to the dust. We therefore commit this body for cremation. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, memory to memory, peace to peace, and love to love. Patricia, Kathleen Graham, Pat, may you now eternally rest in peace. Thank you. You may be seated. As Rebecca and Jim come forward from Simplicity Funerals, I again want to thank you all for your love and your support shown, not just here today, but over the months, the weeks, even the years that you've been around as part of Pat's life. And for family, thank you for allowing me to do the service. It's been a privilege, been an honour for me to do so here today. So if I could invite the pallbearers forward now. We close with a beautiful song by Cat Stevens, Morning Has Broken. Jim and Rebecca, if you could come forward and direct our bearers now, please. Again, you're invited back inside to join us for afternoon tea if you'd like to do so. If you want to follow out to place a tribute on the coffin at the hearse, please feel welcome to follow the family out there. Thank you. Please be upstanding.
Is there